Labą dieną.
Hello everyone. First of all, I want to say that for the last 2 years I haven't spoken in front of a proper audience, so I'm of course a little bit anxious.
I will switch to English for the respect of our previous speakers and the others here present. So my name is Indrė and I represent Gartner Supply Chain Research. I am Lithuanian, but I do live in Paris for the past 16 years also. What a coincidence with just the previous speaker. In the next 15 minutes, I'm going to try to walk you quickly from what we see as the trends impacting the overall supply chain. So as we focus here a lot on the logistics, transport, it is the major actor in the overall end-to-end supply chain. And this is what we research, and this is what they analyze every year. Just to set the scene, so Gartner Supply Chain Research exists for the past 30 years, and they are analyzing the private end-to-end supply chain. So we see what are the best practices, so what are the methodologies that function well, and then we distribute it back to the community. So we do have a larger supply chain community globally. We gather over 2,000 supply chain practitioners. We hired over 200 supply chain subject matter experts, who we call the analysts. Their job is to analyze and to publish the research every year, and we have thousands of those research on all of the different topics. Then it comes to the processes, technologies, digitalization, innovation, you name it, we'll answer. We play it back to the community through the different events, through also personalized advisory. But probably what is the purpose of our existence, it can be also the same reason why you're here in the room today. We are looking to elevate the profession of supply chain. The logistics, we're looking to bring it from the back room to the front room. They're looking to spark the debate and to be the innovation. They're looking to cross-pollinate the ideas, to raise the bar for all, and of course, we're looking to learn from the leaders. And so we are well positioned to know who are the leaders. Every year for the past 17 years, we analyzed the strongest supply chains in the world. Who can participate? Who can be qualified? Only the organizations with the physical good to move can be qualified, and organizations with the 12 billion in the revenue. Now, who decides who is the best? Well, this is your call. There's around 30% of the voting done by the community, so anyone can express their opinion. There's around 30% that's represented by the publicly available data, sorry, everything which is the KPIs on sustainability, CO2 emissions, lean planning, whatever, you name it, we analyze everything to know who is the best supply chain. And then 25% represents our Gartner supply chain subject matter expert opinion. So this is how the top 25 of the supply chain looks for the past year. We announce it in the spring every year, but it's basically done on the achievements of the 2020. And the 2020 wasn't the easy year for the supply chain. I actually admire how quickly we forget the things we went through last year. Lack of mask, lack of this, lack of that, no transfer, lockdown, you name it, it was everything. And they just keep moving now like nothing really happened. We still have to analyze what was done. And so just to put a couple of the highlights, organizations like Cisco, who is voted to be the number one this year, stretched their agility of the supply chain to unprecedented level when it came last year and to develop, manufacture, and distribute all very needed technologies for the hospitals, vaccine research centers. Now, when it comes to the Johnson & Johnson, different industry, same purpose. Last year, they had to demonstrate their innovation and go one step further when it went to the development, manufacturing, and distribution once again of the ventilation machines for the COVID patients across the globe. And that's a big thing. When it comes to more CPG company, consumer good, Nestle, they completely rethought their supply chain, not to be classic through the retail, but go into the e-commerce and direct to the consumer, meaning they had to rethink all of our logistics and all of the network design, especially when it comes to the last mile delivery. Companies like Schneider Electric, French one, their focus was digitalization. What they finalized is what they call the control tower. 70 ERPs come together in one interface where partners of the logistics, suppliers, and clients come together for real-time data and analysis. And that is very powerful when we come to, when we talk about the digitalization. So there are so many examples, and obviously all these companies at the same time focus also on their sustainability topics. So for example, Nestle this year in the beginning replaced 100% of their plastic for one of the yogurts, the most famous Smarties, anybody knows, by the recycled paper, which only this act reduces 400 metric tons of plastic annually. And that is big also. Cisco did everything that they did in the manufacturing of the technologies last year, but at the same time focused on the greenhouse gas reduction. And they have very strong commitment to reduce by 30% in 2025. But in addition, they want 80% of their suppliers, including manufacturing and logistics, to align with their goal of 30% greenhouse gas reduction by 2025. And that impacts the whole ecosystem. Now, I can keep on going with the examples. I'm not going to do it, but we can talk later. Now, the key trends stand out here, and it has been discussed a bit there, a bit here. I'm not going to say anything new, but you'll see that. Organizations are changing the purpose. Organizations are becoming purpose-driven. So what does that mean? Supply chain star turn was in 2020. It means we were in the absolute spotlight. Even my mother knows now what is the supply chain, because everybody was talking, we don't have a paper, we don't have this, we don't have that, it's a fault of transporter, it's a fault of a factory. It was always the fault of a supply chain, and the fingers were pointed. At the same time, many of these private organizations I was just showing before were healing and feeding the world when we were going through the darkest times. So, organizations are changing the purpose. Organizations said also it's the right time now to focus on the environmental, social, governance KPIs, integrate them in the corporate strategy. Get this out from the operational cost and put it rather into the marketing. Communicate to the clients all the great things you do in the sustainability. And that will also help as a benefit to maintain the commitment of your employees. And we know now all, without people, none of this would be possible. So the commitment of the people is extremely important. The second trend, nothing new also. It was mentioned in the previous conversations already. Customer-driven transformation. So the supply chain normally, pre-COVID, were competing on more or less complex client desires, needs, expectations. From one day to the other, everything changed. Supply chains were in front of the unprecedented demand swings, supply lags, and you name it. So the business models suddenly had to change overnight. And to change the supply chain and all the network design and the logistics to be direct to consumer isn't an easy journey to do over the 24 hours. Some of the companies we are analyzing saw their revenue grow by 400% in a couple of weeks, which means what? It's not your revenue only growing, right, in food industry, for example. But there's a demand for supply chain. Please provide, please give, please send, please transport. Yeah, but I don't know how. I cannot, because my supply chain was not agile enough. So here is the key trend. Supply chains are looking to become more adaptive and more agile. The third one, we've been speaking about this also. Obviously, digitalization is a backbone of any transportation. Now, 70% of the CEOs across the globe, they say they're going to be focusing on the digitalization roadmaps for the supply chain now in the coming years. That's great. The primary focus for these digitalizations is going to be e-commerce, direct-to-consumer, and obviously to increase the customer experience, because guess what? Customer experience has become also among the major competitive advantage now. And I'm happy because someone just mentioned in the previous conversation, cybersecurity. None of it, digitalization can be successful if you're not gonna anticipate and you're not gonna think how we actually gonna put the basics for the cyber security. And then it comes also together with all of the competences in the IT, skills that they have in the organizations to maintain and to keep going with digitalization. So these are the macro three trends, nothing new, but this is what the private supply chains are striving for and trying to do. Now we can keep talking about what the successful organizations do, but you know that this, since March 2021, data suggests that they are facing what they call the key shape recovery. Key shape recovery means that not all the industries are reacting the same and not all the industries are capable to recover at the same pace. So the blue clear line is representing, for example, technologies, retail, software. Not only they recovered, but in some cases, they really get the advantage from the pandemics. While the blue dark line goes down, and that is representing, unfortunately, everything which is entertainment, hospitality, travel. Not only companies are struggling to reinvent their model, but in some cases also sinking. 79% of supply chain leaders think that the internet platform-based approach is the most critical new business model to support the post-pandemic recovery. Businesses have to reinvent, businesses have to rethink their supply chain and the transport. 46 and 61% of supply chain leaders anticipate declines in globalization and offshore manufacturing by 2025. It's almost in 3 years, which means that all the network designs, logistics, and transporters will have to adapt to this again. 23% supply chain leaders will have a digital ecosystem by 25, from only 1% today. So that can be encouraging. It can be also a bit alarming because there's gonna be a lot of choices and a lot of decisions taken in very, very short time. And we are well positioned to know that it's a complex decision when it comes to the digitalization. Every year we analyze hundreds of vendors in IT. We analyze thousands of capabilities of digitalization to know what's the best, where do you invest, where do you spend your money, because none of this is free. Every year we publish what they call the hype cycle. So the one on the right is rather for the end-to-end supply chain. The one on the left is purely transport, even people transport. So we can see that a lot of technologies we are talking about is very much hype in fashion to talk about. Like, for example, supply chain blockchain is on the what they call the peak of expectations of this graph. It's only going to be productive in from 5 to 10 years from now. While when we talk about the autonomous vehicle that our minister was just using before, right? Autonomous vehicle, we expect to be productive a bit more than 10 years maybe to make sure we're gonna align with the governance, with all the things, et cetera. It's not that quick, okay? So the companies, when they are thinking, where do I put my cash? Where do I invest into the digitalization? First of all, we have to think what's gonna be the most important for you, for the business where you are. And so there's another trend which is coming up, which is less fortunate and less promising. A lot of businesses are rushing into the digitalization, thinking it's gonna be some kind of silver bullet. I'm gonna get the technology, it's gonna solve my problems. Well, it's not. We see emerging huge gap between the technology maturity and the governance, we call it. So companies invest, they think it's gonna solve the problem, but the competences in the companies are not there. The skills are still not there. We haven't hired people, we haven't fought the process, we haven't adapted our supply chain maturity overall. And this is where it's important to focus. So if I can do just a summary in one phrase, in 30 seconds. Digitalization, innovation is not gonna be the answer without the right maturity, right focus on the competences, on the people we have, and rethinking the business model, what do we want to reach. I wish I could give you more examples. I'm going to ask you to go and check yourself. We have plenty of success stories that are documented in Gartner.com. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Charmant.
Charmant.
Indrė, aš noriu tavęs paklausti visai tokį, nežinau.
Indrė, I would like to ask you.
Padiskutuokim.
Let's have a discussion, okay. Let's have a little brainstorm session. If I ask my client or my Transport Innovation Association members, they would say that in our businesses we're really well digitalized, right, Pavel? So they would say we've digitalized all of our processes, basically we send a message and everything is happening straight away. But if we look at how we've digitalized data exchange between us, we'll see that it's basically non-existent. And the European Commission says, look, we need to think of something. So how do you think, who could be the initiator so that we would start exchanging data and thinking about cybersecurity and other related issues? You've mentioned that we'll have to wait another 10 years for autonomous vehicles, but we could save time because I'm trying to refocus everyone. You know, I have 360 employees who take documents and retype them, and it lasts on average 40 minutes. You know, there's 100 pages that minister managed, so one piece of paper has weight, another one has the price. So imagine how fun it would be, and we've mentioned Girteka, if Girteka loaded on Continental, they get digital data, they give it to Banasta, they want then to Sweden, offload it, and we don't have to pay any extras, because when drivers are in a rush, a lot of things can go wrong.
It's a big question, very large. I mean, it's about visibility, about the transmitting the data, about connecting with different ecosystems, basically. This is what I mentioned, for example, with Schneider, 70 different ERPs coming from the transporters, client, and the suppliers. So it does exist examples like that, but the first of all, it has to grow from a company by company. Already we see so many organizations not ready or not capable of transmitting data from one business unit to another. So that's one thing. And then it comes transmitting all this data to another company, it's even more work to be done. So first of all, let's look at the maturity of our digitalization one by one, and then how can we digitalize the whole ecosystem, we call it. Ecosystem of one company is the transporters, sort of suppliers, and you name it, plenty of people who come to
custom
work together.
Custom brokers and so.
But orchestration. Did I answer it? It's way too long to handle it here.
Of course. Thank you very much, Indra.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.